Ladies and gentlemen, I propose to start off with the meeting. Welcome to you all at this 2013 version of the annual lecture of the Scientific Council for Government Policy, the WRR. We have an intriguing title today of the event. In fact, we have two titles. The first title is How Much Inequality Can Societies Sustain? And the second title is How Much Equality Societies Can Sustain? And that underlines the open mind with which we are going to listen to our keynote speaker, Professor Richard Wilkinson from the UK, and the subsequent compact presentations and reflections by Professors De Beer, Van Bavel, and Strongs. Thank you all for coming, especially the speakers, but you all in such a large amount of interested and involved people. And we're also going to listen to a subsequent debate on the Dutch situation, and that debate will be later introduced and moderated by Council Member Professor Mark Bovens, who is, by the way, also leading a WRR project on nowadays social divides, he will take over the session chair after Richard's keynote. First, some practical remarks. Please check and switch off your mobile phones, or at least make them silent during the session. Second, in your package, you will find an evaluation form, and you're kindly requested to fill that out at the end of the session and hand it over to our colleagues when leaving this church, and we will be very happy to hear your feedback. And third, the debate will be in Dutch, but don't worry, we will not have a social divide there because we will keep Professor Wilkinson in with the help of real-time translation. Ladies and gentlemen, let's now start with the content you came for. In the past years, social inequality strongly has come back to the public attention. Reports of the World Bank, the IMF, and the OECD, for example, report on increasing inequality internationally. And new studies also suggest that more inequality is associated to less economic growth, more social problems, and maybe even disadvantages to the functioning of our democracy. But at the other hand, it is suggested that there's also something as too much equality, in the sense that people's motivation to improve their performance, to excel, would be less in such a situation. The debate later this afternoon will therefore explore those issues, and in addition, especially for the Dutch perspective, we will discuss whether the Dutch society is really as equal as we think, and also we will discuss whether we need new policies and whether these policies are possible. Ladies and gentlemen, with Richard Wilkinson, we have an outstanding speaker for the opening lecture of today. He is first author, with Kate Pickett as a co-author, of the well-known book, The Spirit Level, Why More Equal Societies Almost Always Do Better. And his book was translated in numerous languages, and the authors received prestigious awards for it. Richard Wilkinson is Professor Emeritus in Social Epidemiology at the University of Nottingham. He is also Honorary Professor at the University College of London and Professor at the University of York. And his early work on social determinants of health have already at the time been very effective, had a lot of impact in the sense that it, for example, initiated the publication of the famous Black Report, which has put the issue of health inequality very much on the international agenda already at the time. Professor Wilkinson, the floor is yours.
Thank you. I always start off by taking off my jacket. I get hot while I'm speaking. Well, thank you for coming, and it's wonderful to have this opportunity to talk about my obsessions. For many years, these were private obsessions, but they've now become public. I've worked on first health inequalities and then the wider effects of income inequality for a long time. I sometimes start off by telling audiences that I'm going to tell you what you know already. And if I asked you which country has the highest levels, which of the rich developed countries have the highest levels of violence, the biggest prison populations, the highest levels of obesity, you'd know it was the United States. If I asked you which ones do well on all those things, you'd know it was the Scandinavian countries. I think the only thing that surprises people is how closely these sorts of outcomes relate to income inequality, not only at the extremes, the United States and the Scandinavian countries, but also in between. In fact, in our work, you can remove those countries at the extreme and you've still got a significant correlation. Anyway, I'm going to go quickly through our data. I'd like to start off with this picture because it, in a way, it shows the failure of our modern societies. I mean, those are people in the prime of life going to work in the morning in Oxford Street in London. Every face there is miserable. Haggard, anxious, bad-tempered, grumpy. Even the ones talking to their friends on the phone, that's true of. So I do think that part of what I have to say is relevant to the contrast between the material success of our societies and their many social failings. And indeed, I think if we're going to move towards sustainability, we have to think about the other ways that we need to improve our societies. This is what I call the social deficit, but I'll touch on that later. Responsible for people in the prime of life going to good jobs. These are not the poor and unemployed or anyone like that. Living lives that they feel in many ways are, I think, unsatisfactory. What I have to say is as simple as that. That the more income inequality there is, the more of a whole range of problems you get. I was delighted to find this on Google Images. I thought, somebody has understood. I didn't draw that graph. But what I'm going to show you is the same thing over and over again. I'm going to show you different problems up the side in relation to this each time, the same measure of income inequality. I think that it's important to recognize, and most of the time in research, people study individual risk factors, you know, whether it's for violence or addiction or poor health or anything else. But there are two quite different ways of looking at any of these problems. And as this slide I found tries to show, you know, if you're trying to account for individual failure, the people who don't manage to jump over these hurdles, then you look at individual differences. If you want to know the proportion of them who fall, you need to know about the height of the hurdles. And I'm talking about the social environment, the social economic environment that makes our lives more or less difficult. Our book is sometimes called A Theory of Everything because we deal with so many outcomes. I mean, not only physical health, but mental health, social cohesion, how much people feel they can trust others, how well school children do in these maths and literacy international tests, drug abuse, homicide rates, the proportion of the population in prison, measures of child well-being. But it's not a theory of everything. It's a theory of problems that are more common at the bottom of society. You know, although depression and mental illness exist at the top, they're all more common at the bottom. I think most people look at those social gradients and they think they're partly a product or mainly a product of social mobility. You know, the vulnerable move down and the resilient move up, and that's why we get these differences. But if I sorted this audience by, I don't know, hair color, let's say, let's have the gray-haired ones that side and the dark-haired ones that side, sorting you doesn't change the proportion of hair color in the room. But I'm going to show you these problems are anything from twice as common to 10 times as common in the developed countries with the bigger income differences. What I think that means is that we are looking at problems which are substantially responses to social status differentiation itself. And in a way, I'm saying something extraordinarily simple, that problems that we know are related to social status get worse when you increase the social status differences. The surprise is that they're not just more common amongst the bottom of society. Inequality seems to damage the whole social fabric, so the vast majority of the population suffer adverse effects of inequality. I'll show you that later. I'd like to start with this graph, after those preliminary remarks, because it's looking at life expectancy in relation to national income per head. And what you're seeing is a rapid rise in life expectancy in the early stages of economic growth and then a leveling off. What's interesting is if you look at measures of happiness or well-being, you get very much the same shape. Rapid rises early in development and then leveling off. I think this is a curve of diminishing returns to economic growth. You know, that economic growth is really what's transformed the quality of our lives, but it's largely done its work. My first degree was in economic history, and it seemed to me inevitable that at some point we would reach, higher material standards really are important in the poorer countries. But for us in the rich world, having more and more of everything makes less and less difference. And I think that's a really important issue when you think about the environmental consequences. But for me, I mention it now because I am going to be talking about those rich developed countries on the top right where GNP per capita seems no longer to matter. Although health increases over time, it's no longer related to economic growth. My next slide is one from, Angus Deaton, amongst others. Angus Deaton was president of the American Economic Association a few years ago. And he says, even when you look at changes over 10, 20, or 40 years, you see almost no relationship between economic growth and the improvements in life expectancy we go on getting. So I think economic growth has largely finished its work in the developed countries. It's really important work. Now, these are the countries I'm going to talk about, and this is just an expansion of those countries on the top right-hand part of that previous graph. And this time, big enough for you to be able to read them. And you see countries like Norway and the USA are twice as rich as countries like Israel, Greece, and Portugal on the left, and it has no consequences whatsoever. There isn't even a suggestion of a relationship there. But within every society, I was hearing now with better measurements of socioeconomic position in the Netherlands, you're aware between education groups of 7-year differences in life expectancy. That's the biggest human rights abuse in modern societies, these huge health inequalities. In a way, it's worse than locking people up without trial. But look, income appears not to mean anything between our rich developed societies, but within them, there are these extraordinary social gradients in health right across society. I'm sorry this isn't Dutch data. It comes from England and Wales. These are small neighborhoods. And they're classified by how rich or poor the neighborhood is. So on the right, you've got the poorest neighborhoods with short life expectancy, and on the left, the rich ones. This isn't a difference between the poor and the rest of society. If you think about homelessness I hope you don't have homelessness here. We do in Britain. But you do have unemployment. That's a small contribution to the right-hand end of it. That kind of thinking doesn't help you understand this gradient going right across society. We're all part of the pattern of health inequalities. Michael Marmot, who's perhaps the world's foremost researcher on these issues, says you can take away all the problem of poverty and poor health and you've still got most of the problem of health inequalities left. So you need some other way of understanding it. But it's a paradox that income means something, it appears to mean something very important within our societies, but didn't between them. The explanation of that paradox is that here within our societies we're looking at the effects of relative income or social position, social status, where we are in relation to each other. And as soon as you've got that idea that this is about relativities, then you need to think, what happens if we make the differences between us bigger or smaller? And that's really what I want to talk about. This is not a theoretical exercise. We don't talk about perfectly equal societies because they don't exist. We simply download data from international websites. Our inequality data here comes from the UN Human Development Report website. When we downloaded it, it was the same data as the World Bank were using. We had a choice of using the Gini coefficient that they had or this measure of the gap between the top and bottom 20%. We took that one simply because it's easier for people to understand. We were trying to write a popular book to communicate a picture that had been slowly coming together in the social epidemiology. And you see that the more equal countries, on the left, Japan, Finland, Norway, Sweden, Denmark, the Netherlands, just to the left of the middle, slightly more equal than the average. But those more equal countries, the top 20% are getting 3.5 or 4 times as much as the bottom 20%. But in the more unequal countries, Singapore, USA, Portugal, the UK, the gap is twice as big. Now, on that measure of inequality, some of these rich developed market democracies, you know, these are not odd societies who had a very odd pattern of development. These are all the rich developed market democracies, old democracies. You still find that enormous difference between them, which allows us to start to think what difference it makes. Now, I like to put up this slide because I think people have an extraordinarily simple-minded... I'm sorry, you haven't got a simple-minded view of inequality, but I think people often do. There's a naive view that that all that matters is poverty, or perhaps it matters if people think that income differences are very unfair, but otherwise there's nothing to worry about. But actually, inequality brings with it all sorts of other effects to do with our evolved psychology, our sensitivity to dominance and subordination, superiority and inferiority. It changes the relationship between us. It increases anxieties about self-worth. You know, if everyone's ordered by some idea of, you know, value, people at the top being walking about, I see I'm making it very difficult for these cameras. I'm sorry. So I think we need to think much more carefully about what these issues are of superiority and inferiority, our sensitivities to those, what they do to us. To understand these things, you need to think about our evolved psychology. What we did was collect data on problems with these social gradients. We never decided what data is comparable with what, because that would introduce an element of bias. We simply downloaded what international websites have. So life expectancy comes from World Health Organization, maths and literacy scores from OECD, infant mortality, of course, from WHO, trust from the World Values Survey, obesity from the International Obesity Task Force. And basically, we have a rule that if our data source has data for one of the countries we're looking at, it goes into the analysis. We make no judgments of the data. Yet we get accused of picking and choosing data, but I say, if you don't like the data, don't complain to us. Complain to OECD or whoever. Here we put it all together in one index. for those of you who've done some statistics, we use Z-scores. So they're all weighted equally. Where a country is its sort of average performance, and there you see that the more unequal countries, USA, Portugal, UK, doing worse on all those things, and the more equal ones doing, the Scandinavians and Japan doing better. Look at the same index in relation to national income per person, and you see there's no connection. We thought we'd be criticized that people would say we were choosing problems to suit our argument. In fact, those are the most important things you'd expect to find international data for on problems with social gradients. But we decided to look at the UNICEF index of child well-being. We did a paper in the British Medical Journal on the UNICEF index of child well-being. It's important because it has 40 different variables. It was made to look at child well-being in the rich developed countries. It contains whether children can talk to their parents, whether there's bullying at school, whether they have books at home, what immunization rates and child health are like. All that goes into it. And here it is in relation to that same measure of income inequality. The more unequal societies doing worse in terms of child well-being. But again, if you look at that same measure of child well-being in relation to national income per person, there's no relationship. So although, you know, children's charities talk a great deal about child poverty as the problem, we have to distinguish between relative poverty and absolute poverty. You know, I think they don't distinguish because it makes it less politically controversial. If it's absolute poverty, then, you know, incentives to industry and economic growth might solve the problem if you manage to get some trickle down. But actually, the data shows quite clearly it's about relative poverty. It's where children are in relation to the rest of society or how unequal the societies are that they're growing up in. So whether you look at our index or this child well-being index, or think about the paradox that income means so much apparently within our societies but not between them. You know, this is all telling the same story rather powerfully. That it's the differences between us that matter now, no longer the absolute standards. I want to move on to show you quickly some of the separate components of our index. This is trust from the World Values Survey. It's interesting that at the right hand, the unequal side, only 15 or 20% of the population feel they can trust others, whereas it rises to 60 or 65% amongst the more equal countries. If you look at Robert Putnam's measures of inequality in bowling alone, or his earlier study of the Italian regions, making democracy work. He's not very keen on inequality, but so you have to either read the footnotes or do a bit of statistical work yourself with his measures of social capital. You find just the same relationships. There are now quite a number of papers on trust and social cohesion showing relationships with inequality. We did the work twice, once on the rich developed countries, and then we repeated it all on the American states because we wanted a different test bed, asking the same question, do the more unequal countries do worse? And they do. The picture is very similar. There are a few differences, but this is the same measure of trust, this time from the federal government's general social survey. It's a similar scatter. Bullying. I think bullying is important. This is someone else's work. Frank Elgar in Canada, a much bigger group of countries. We did look at bullying, but on a different data set. But I think bullying is important because it shows, I mean, think of animal dominance hierarchies, the way, you know, the big baboon, the strongest baboon at the top, maintains its power over others. In adults, we don't have those sorts of measures. of how we treat each other, the downward prejudice of the of anything like bullying. But you do see it in its rawest form amongst children, I think, at school. You know, children can be brutal to each other. I think this is quite symptomatic of the underlying effects of social hierarchy related to our evolved psychology. This is mental illness. It's not people coming into their doctor for antidepressants, because that would be too influenced by how you access medical care in different countries, whether or not you pay for it. To get these figures, WHO, to allow us to make good comparisons of levels of mental illness in each country, used the same diagnostic interviews on random samples of the population. So you were not asked, have you been diagnosed with depression? You asked about your appetite and your sleeping and various things about self-worth and so on that have been found to be diagnostic of mental illness. And anyway, up the side, you've got the proportion of the population with any mental illness in the preceding year. And it goes from about 8% up to three times that level. So for every person a Japanese knows who is clinically depressed, Americans will know three. And it's an extraordinary difference. What is this one? Schizophrenia. Yeah, quite big differences there. That's somebody else's work. It's come out fairly recently. This is infant mortality. Sort of twofold differences. This is life expectancy, which is one of the weakest relationships. It used to be stronger when the most important influences on life expectancy were death rates at younger ages. Life expectancy was more closely related to income inequality. Income inequality is not closely related to deaths in later life, which are now the important thing influencing international differences in life expectancy, because death rates at lower ages have declined so much. I don't know whether deaths in old age are less related to inequality because it's not current inequality that matters, but a lifetime experience. I think there might be something in that, because we know that if you measure social status in childhood, in early adulthood, and later in working life, they're all independently important as determinants of health in later life. So maybe, you know, the problem is looking at current inequality. This is homicide rates. Those red dots are American states. The blue ones are Canadian provinces. Again, that's not our work. That comes from Martin Daly and Margot Wilson. At McMaster in Canada, spent a lifetime studying violence, good evolutionary psychologists. But look at the scale of differences. The blue triangles on the left, you've got about 15 homicides per million, and it goes up to 150. One of my problems with this data is that people who don't like it think that we've produced this picture out of the air, that we're the only people who produced it. But actually, there are about 50 papers now in the journals on inequality and violence in lots of different contexts. And a meta-analysis, even, I think it was in 1993, as early as that, said it was a robust relationship. Imprisonment. Note there's a log scale up the side, which means the intervening points are a bit higher than you might expect. So that goes from about 40 to 400 people, a tenfold difference in prison populations. Some American states have spent more on prisons than on higher education. You can't, I think, avoid social expenditure. You just have a choice of how to spend it. There's now a paper on, I think they call it defensive expenditure, i.e. spending on police and security and prisons and so on. That's an American paper with American data. But this relationship here is only partly about more crime. Most of it is driven by more punitive sentencing in more unequal societies. And, you know, I showed you the graph on trust earlier. And I think this is another indication of the quality of social relations being damaged in more unequal societies. I don't know whether it is simply less trust, but it might be lack of empathy. It might be more fear up and down the social hierarchy that leads to more punitive sentencing. The countries on the right also are more likely to use the death penalty. Teenage birth rates, that's births per 1,000 women in their teens, and it goes from about 5 up to, if you include the USA, that's a bit of an outlier. It's a tenfold difference again. Okay, this is the last of these ones that so far my message has been pretty clear. Things get worse in more unequal societies. But this is social mobility. It's important because people increasingly say that big inequalities of income are fair if everyone can reach their appropriate level in society. The idea that if you're clever and work hard, you become richer. This shows that social mobility is lower in more unequal societies. The measure of mobility is income-related, so it uses big cohort studies in each country and relates father's income at the time, I'm afraid it's father's and son's, father's income when a son is born to the son's income when he reaches the age of 30. So it does depend on these long follow-up cohort studies. So it's asking, do rich fathers have rich sons and poor fathers poor sons? And it looks as if father's income is much more important in the more unequal societies on the right. We published this when there was much less data available. Well, I say much less, but in that case, I mean just, I think, a couple more countries' data has come in that I'm showing you here. But since then, Alan Kruger, the chair of Obama's Economic Advisory Committee, has produced almost exactly the same picture based on quite independent data. And 2 days ago, we found that somebody has done calculations of social mobility in each of the American metropolitan areas, and it too is related to inequality. So I think we're now pretty confident that, and whether you regard the social ladder as being steeper and harder to get up, or the rungs on the ladder further apart, or however you view it, I think that what this graph is telling us is that you cannot have equal opportunities for children with big inequalities of outcome. No country gets anywhere near that. I'm going to skip over this. It's just a summary of the things we've looked at. I don't know whether you probably don't want to look at statistics now, but some people say we should have used a different set of income inequality data. So we've shown it there internationally and for the American states. The main difference between the OECD and the UN inequality data is that Japan is much more unequal on the OECD data. People don't realize actually that the Japanese data the OECD uses before tax. So the differences are bigger. There's been actually a study funded by the Japanese, involving British and Japanese researchers, and they decided that Japanese income distribution is still much more like the Scandinavian countries. People have looked at lag periods over time, so the upper panel shows you what happens if you get a change in income inequality. The effects come through to affect health after about 3 years and continue the marginal effects each year, pushing mortality up up until about 12 years, and then the cumulative effects on the lower panel. Now, people often think that income inequality has been rising, but health goes on improving. What happens is that health improves more slowly in countries that become more equal and faster in countries that become more unequal and faster in countries that become more equal. It's only when you get really catastrophic rises in inequality, as happened in Russia and some of the Eastern European countries, that you get these awful increases in mortality that they went through. Because we've presented a very simple picture in our book, people imagine that there's no more sophisticated analysis around. This is a multi-level study it's a meta-analysis of multi-level studies, including cohort studies. So you're following the same people through over time, watching their mortality rates change as income inequality changes, covering individual data for about 60 million people. So you're controlling for individual income, you're looking at it over time, and still you see these effects. I think I might skip over that too, as I've talked about it. Why these differences are so big? You know, anything from twice as much infant mortality or three times as much mental illness to 10 times as much violence in some of the studies, or imprisonment or teenage birth rates, all 10 times as high, is because it isn't just the poor who are affected. Where we can look at people at each level in the social hierarchy and compare them between more and less equal countries, you can see that more equal countries do better right across the social scale. This is old data when we were beginning to wonder were health inequalities the same in every country or were they different? And some Swedish researchers classified some of their infant deaths according to our occupational class classification in England and Wales. So because it's anachronistically a classification by father's occupation, single mothers are in their own group. Then you have the low father's occupational class is unskilled manual workers. Next to that is semi-skilled, then skilled manual. Then there's junior non-manual, clerical workers. Then there's intermediate non-manual, who are people like nurses and teachers. And at the top, the professional occupations, doctors, lawyers, directors of larger companies, and that's group. And you see Sweden does better right across the scale with low infant mortalities. The differences are biggest at the bottom of society, but even at the top, they seem to have an advantage. We now know of about 6 data sets that show that same pattern. We produce some of them in our book. And some of Kate's students, PhD students, have been looking at children's cognitive development in more and less equal studies and find the same basic pattern, that people do better right across the scale in more equal societies, but the differences are much bigger at the bottom of society than the top. We can't talk about the super rich because we don't have data on that fraction of 1%. People always want to say, even the rich do better. But we don't have data on violence and drug abuse and so on. We don't know what happens to them, but we can say that 90 or 95% of the population does better in terms of these kinds of outcomes. I'm going to skip that too for shortage of time, but it shows the same fanning out. It's at the bottom that the big differences are biggest. I think what we're talking about is not something separate from social class. It's telling us more about the social class processes we've always known about. We do spend some time talking about causality in each terms of each outcome in our book, but the simple view of causality is that all the ways in which social class imprints itself on us, from earliest childhood onwards, I think become more powerful with greater material differences between us. That if you like, the bigger material differences provide the framework around which all the cultural differences establish themselves. And really we're looking at whether society is a very steep or much shallower pyramid. But with that goes all the worries about how you're seen and judged. I skip that too. You know, if some people are so important and others so unimportant, it makes us all more worried about how we are seen and judged. More issues to do with superiority and inferiority, driving consumerism. You know, people in more unequal societies work longer hours and they spend more of their income, they save less, they get into debt more, because money is even more important. It's how you show what you're worth. And one of the implications, of course, is if we want to move towards sustainability, consumerism is one of the main obstacles. You can only, I think, reduce consumerism, I shouldn't say only, but an important part of reducing consumerism, I think, is to reduce inequality. That valued or devalued, just one quick thing about it. We found in the 100 biggest companies that in the FTSE 100 share index in Britain that the average pay ratio between the CEO and the bottom full-time worker is 300 to 1. There's no more powerful way of telling a whole group of the population that you are worth almost nothing than to pay you 1/3 of 1% of what somebody else in the same company gets. And then, you know, there's a tendency to say that the problem with the poor is low self-esteem. That's really rubbing salt into the wounds. And then we're surprised in, I'm sorry to talk rather my own country, but in our riots 2 years ago, what the kids from poor areas were doing was stealing markers of status. The electronics and clothes with the right goods. One of the ways in which you see, I must be very quick now, one of the ways in which you see the effects of the bigger social evaluative judgments, the worries about how you're seen, that is, as lots of research has now shown, what really pushes up our levels of stress hormones are situations in which we are exposed to what they call social evaluative threats, threats to self-esteem or social status, where you can be judged negatively. That fits very well with the health research about the importance of social status, friendship, early life. But there are two responses to that. I must get to, two responses to feeling more worried about social judgments. One is that you get overcome by social anxieties. Social contact becomes an ordeal. Problems of low self-esteem, lack of confidence, and so on. The other is that you talk yourself up. You start, instead of being modest about your achievements and abilities, you start to flaunt them. And this shows its suggestive rise of narcissism that comes from Jean Twenge, who specializes in the States in looking at population psychological changes over time. And we've just put the trends in inequality on top of it. Another indication is this that, again, has come out much more recently than our book, looking at what they call self-enhancement, self-aggrandizement in more and less equal countries, an international team, asking people in each of those countries how they think they compare to the average in their country. Do you think you're cleverer than average? Do you think you're better looking than the average? Do you think you're more generous than the average? Do you think you're better drivers than the average? And people rate themselves higher, not because they really believe that they're better at everything. It's a defense against the fragile egos and your worries about how you're seen and judged. I'm sorry not to have time to do some of that, but you know, there are different ways of approaching this problem of reducing income inequalities. Taxes and benefits are only part of the solution. More fundamental, I think, is improving all forms of economic democracy. I think we must have stronger legislation for employee representation on company boards. Many European countries have that. It needs to be strengthened. All countries should have it. But we must also promote democracy in terms of employee-owned companies and cooperatives. We must grow that sector of our economy. maybe with tax incentives to those kinds of companies. We should, as consumers, shop from companies with smaller differences or more democratic companies. It's a much more fundamental approach to the problem. I can only see the bonus culture as an indication of a lack of any democratic constraint at the top. Lots that more I would have loved to have told you about, but not time. If you want some of these slides or ideas about campaigning or want to know more what we think of the mechanisms in each of these outcomes, those are the possible sources. Thank you.